requirements.
Thank you. That concludes general questions. The next item of business is First Minister's questions. And at question number one, I call Douglas Ross.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A week ago, I lodged the Scottish Conservative vote of no confidence that forced Hamza Yousaf to resign in disgrace. This could very well be his final FMQs as First Minister. Hamza Yousaf's replacement must focus on what really matters to Scotland. They have to forget about independence and prioritise growing our economy, creating jobs, improving public services. John Swinney did the opposite of all of these things in government, and his leadership campaign slogan, unveiled this morning, is Uniting for Independence. All he offers.
Members, let's hear Mr. Ross. Members,
I'm very, very grateful for that party election broadcast we will be using in the days, weeks and months to come, because all he offers is more of the same nationalist obsession that has damaged Scotland for a decade, and they are laughing and applauding that. He is fixated on independence, not the things that really matter. Doesn't uniting for independence just mean more division for Scotland?
First Minister.
No, it doesn't, Presiding Officer. Let me say to Douglas Ross, of course he has every right and prerogative to gloat about the position that I am in, and of course made that statement on Monday. The only exception I would take to Douglas Ross is, no, I don't feel disgraced at all. I'm very proud of the fact that I became the first person of colour to be the First Minister. Muslim leader of a Western nation, the youngest First Minister to ever serve in 25 years of devolution. And most of all, I'm proud to have served my government, this government, my country, for 12 years on the front benches. Did I get everything right? Absolutely not. And that is very evident and very clear. But can I be proud of this government's record? Absolutely. And let me just talk about the government's record, because Douglas Ross will do his best in the next few questions to talk about personalities as opposed to talk about policies. And why would he want to do that, Presiding Officer? Because when it comes to our policies, the SNP, of course, is the party of free university education. We're the party that abolished prescription charges. We're the party of free personal and nursing care. We're the party of free bus travel for those who are under 22, over 60, those with a disability. We're the party of free school meals, the party of the baby box, the party of free childcare. And what about the Conservatives, Presiding Officer? They are the party of Windrush. They're the party of bankers' bonuses. They're the party of austerity, the party of Brexit, the party of the two-child limit, the party of Boris Johnson, the party of Liz Truss, the party of the cost of living crisis. So with such an abysmal record, no wonder the leader of the nasty party wants to talk about personalities and not policies.
Douglas Ross.
I mean, my criticism of the government was mainly brought on by John Swinney's comments today that says everything's so bad, he's got to run for the leadership. And just when he thought, just when John Swinney thought he was out, they pull him back in, because literally there is nobody else. The SNP's man for the future is their failed leader from the past, from one continuity candidate to another. John Swinney was Nicola Sturgeon's human shield. He masterminded the deal with the extremist Greens. For 16 out of the 17 years of SNP government, John Swinney sat round the cabinet table. His fingerprints are all over their most toxic policies. How will going back to the future get the SNP out of the mess that they're in?
First Minister.
Has Douglas Ross never stopped to reflect that for all that he said about John Swinney, of course, John Swinney and, of course, my colleague Kate Forbes are both more popular than Douglas Ross, Presiding Officer. And Douglas Ross seems absolutely determined to talk about personality. So let me remind him about the personalities he associates himself with. Yep. Douglas Ross served in Boris Johnson's government. Yep. He called Boris Johnson an honest man. Yep. That would be the Boris Johnson who was not only the architect of a damaging hard Brexit, but Boris Johnson allegedly said to COVID victims, let the bodies pile up high. Yeah. Douglas Ross then went on to not only support Liz Truss to the hilt.
Members.
He demanded that we copy Liz Truss's disastrous tax plans. Those, of course, were tax plans that utterly annihilated the economy. And that is the Liz Truss who's now engaging in hard right conspiracies about the deep state. You can judge a man, presiding officer, you can judge a man by the company he keeps. And Douglas Ross's company is Boris Johnson, the Conservative Party of Liz Truss, of Suella Braverman, Priti Patel, formerly Lee Anderson, Mark Menzies, Peter Bone, Chris Pincher, Andrew Bridgen, Frank Hester. And I can see Douglas Ross looking more and more embarrassed. And let me say, that is the company
members.
He keeps. I'm very proud of John Swinney, Kate Forbes, and all of the company that I keep, presiding officer.
Douglas Ross. Let's hear Mr. Ross. Thank you, members. Douglas Ross.
I mean, he's talking a big game now. Has he forgotten? It was just last Friday he wrote this humiliating letter to me begging the Conservatives and our colleagues here to save his skin. He literally was begging us to save his job. That's how quickly things change in the world of Hamza Yousaf. But let's go back to John Swinney. They think John Swinney is a safe pair of hands, but he has dropped the ball dozens of times. He was Deputy First Minister who stood right by Nicola Sturgeon when she obsessed about independence, when she increased taxes, when she wrecked Scotland's public services. He was the architect of the hated named persons law. He deleted every WhatsApp message that should have gone to the UK COVID inquiry in a disgraceful cover-up. He was Education
Members.
Secretary. John Swinney was Education Secretary, who let our schools spiral down international league tables below Estonia, Latvia and Hungary. The man who oversaw the disastrous ferries deal is supposed to steady the ship. Is this really the best the SNP can do?
First Minister.
So let's then compare records, of course. John Swinney was part of a government that set up Social Security Scotland through our anti-poverty measures, including through the benefits that are awarded through Social Security Scotland. And I can hear the Conservatives saying those anti-poverty measures aren't working. They're estimated to lift 100,000 children out of poverty this year. In very stark contrast to the Conservatives, it is through John Swinney's efforts in education, the foundations that he laid, that we now have more young people going to universities from areas of deprivation than ever before. It's through John Swinney who helped deliver the biggest expansion of early learning and childcare in our country's history. Well, let's look at Douglas Ross's record. Douglas Ross's voting record is there on, for example, websites like the Work For You, who aggregate and assess the voting records of all MPs. On taxation and employment, Douglas Ross generally voted against higher taxes on banks. When it comes to veterans, generally voted against strengthening the military covenant. When it comes to environmental issues, Douglas Ross generally voted
against
measures.
Let's hear the First Minister.
They're getting worked up. It's all there in black and white. He can't hide from the truth, presiding officer. The website also says that he voted against improving. Oh, I've got them in.
I think we've gone well beyond the point at which we can hear one another. I've only called one person to speak, as far as I'm aware, and I'd like to hear the person who's called to speak, and them alone, First Minister.
They don't like the truth, presiding officer. They don't like it one bit, because that truth shows that Douglas Ross generally voted against measures to prevent climate change. Yeah. What a surprise. Generally voted against improving air quality. Generally voted against laws to promote equality and human rights. Let's find something he did vote for, presiding officer. He voted for the Rwanda bill, presiding officer. What a shameful act. What a disgrace. So be it John Swinney, be it Kate Forbes or any one of my colleagues. They can stand proudly on their record. Can Douglas Ross stand proudly on his?
Douglas Ross.
Well, Hamza Youssef is lashing out today because he knows it was the Scottish Conservatives that forced him out of his job. And he knows that in the election coming, in seats up and down Scotland, it's a straight fight between the SNP and my party. We'll stand on our record of forcing him out of office,
Let's hear Mr. Ross.
Holding this tired and failing SNP government to account. But what will John Swinney and the SNP stand on? John Swinney has confirmed today he will be another divisive nationalist, focused only on independence. His campaign slogan is literally uniting for independence. That means more division for Scotland all over again. John Swinney has been at the heart of the failures that have defined the SNP's time in office. How on earth will the SNP stop failing Scotland if they keep doing the same thing over and over again?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, colleagues who will be potentially standing for leadership of my party, they will stand on a record that we will take to the people of Scotland, much like, of course, his party today are taking their record in local elections down in England and Wales. And one suspects, Presiding Officer, that the people will give them a very harsh verdict indeed.
Mr. Ross.
And when it comes to the issue of independence,
Mr. Ross.
Presiding Officer, let's make it very, very clear that when it comes to a vote on the constitutional future of this country, a mandate that we have stood on and won election after election on. The only reason that Westminster refuses to give that second referendum is because they fear the verdict, Presiding Officer. And why do we need independence? We need independence because this country has suffered 14 years of austerity from a government that hasn't won an election in Scotland since the 1950s. It's because we have a Brexit foisted upon us that we did not vote for. It's because our people are suffering from a cost of living crisis that they didn't create, but they are the ones who are suffering as a result of. So what drives John Swinney, what drives Kate Forbes, what drives every single one of the colleagues beside me and behind me is our social contract with the people. It's the social contract with the people, today and night, to work in the service of all of the communities in Scotland. And I've got no doubt that when we take that record that I stand proudly on and my successor will stand proudly on, I've got no doubt at all that they'll continue to put their trust in the SNP, Presiding.
Question number two, Anna Sarwar.
Presiding Officer, Scotland cannot afford this distracted, divided and incompetent SNP government. And look past all the shouting. Our country is facing the greatest challenges since the creation of this parliament. Over 800,000 people on an NHS waiting list. Increasing violence and falling standards in our schools. Police numbers being cut and crimes not being investigated. I would remind Mr. Brown that we are talking about his constituents as well who are suffering these consequences. Police numbers being cut and crimes not being investigated. Almost 10,000 children living in temporary accommodation. Millions of pounds wasted on failed projects and our economy flatlining while the huge potential of our people is squandered. But yet again, the SNP are putting party before country and their own problems before the people of Scotland. So isn't it the case that regardless of who the SNP impose, they won't be able to fix this mess and deliver the change Scotland needs?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I don't obviously agree with that in the slightest. What I would say about some of the issues that Anna Sarwar has raised, of course there are challenges, particularly in the face of a recovery from a global pandemic, but the NHS and our public services, what we are doing is we're choosing to invest in those public services as opposed to tax cuts for the wealthy, which of course is the choice of the UK Conservative Party, but it seems now also the choice of the UK Labour Party. And Anna Sarwar once stood in a platform of progressive taxation, but that, like all of his other principles, has gone out of the window. So Anna Sarwar asks us to concentrate on the day job. Can I remind him that it was Anas Sawar and his party that yesterday brought forward a motion of no confidence to this parliament that they knew that they were going to lose? Yeah. And due to that waste of time, we had less time to debate justice and compensation for the WASPI woman. Yeah. And perhaps, presiding officer, Anas Sawar wanted it that way. Yeah. Because for all of the photographs he takes with the WASPI woman, for all of the warm words, for all of the hugs he gives to the WASPI woman, it was a disgrace that the Labour Party, led by Anas Sawar, abstained on a motion that demanded full compensation for women who have suffered such a disgraceful injustice. So while we're getting on with the day job, while we're getting on with serving the people of Scotland, Anas Sawar and his Labour Party are U-turning, flip-flopping, deflecting, and don't think that the people of Scotland can't see through that. Yeah.
Anas Sawar.
Things are going so well, he's stepping down this week, and he's now giving us political advice after the week he just had himself. I don't think you could make it up. Because regardless of the list,
Let's hear Mr. Sawar.
First Minister wants to read out, it doesn't reflect the lived reality for people in Scotland right now under this SNP government. And so, while our country is crying out for change, what is the SNP's answer? An internal stitch-up and more of the same. Either the man who broke the public finances, or who was the worst education secretary in the history of the Scottish Parliament, or the Deputy First Minister that deleted evidence to the COVID inquiry, and the man who has been at the heart of this incompetent SNP government for the past 17 years, or the former Deputy First Minister, who many on her own benches say should be more akin to Douglas Ross's party than her own. Both represent chaos. Both represent division. Both represent more of the same. After 17 years of incompetence and failure, is this really the best the SNP has to offer?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, Anas Sawar talks about leadership stitch-ups. He should know about that. Just ask Richard Leonard about what he did about leadership stitch-ups, Presiding Officer. Our record, Presiding Officer, has seen more young people going to university from deprived areas than ever before. Our record, of course, has delivered over 128,000 affordable homes. Our record has established Social Security Scotland, 14 benefits, 7 of which are only available in Scotland, including the Scottish Child Payment, game-changing Scottish Child Payment, estimated to lift 100,000 children out of poverty through our anti-poverty measures. And Anas Sawar talks about what the government has been doing over the last 2 weeks. In the last 2 weeks alone, we've announced £80 million of additional funds to ensure that we boost our affordable housing stock. And on top of that, we confirmed £11 million of grant funding for public bodies such as leisure centres. And what have Anas Sawar and the Labour Party done in the last 2 weeks? Yeah. They voted against keeping the promise to care experienced children. They are going to water down their plans for workers and announce that on May Day of all days, Presiding Officer. And once again, disgracefully, they refuse to back justice and compensation for the WASPI women. A betrayal, Presiding Officer, that they will not be forgiven for.
Anas Sawar.
Presiding Officer, the First Minister cut £189 million from the housing budget and then miraculously found £80 million the day he was begging to keep his job. People can see right through the sham. And as so many in his own party have said, continuity won't cut it. We need a government that is focused on fixing the mess the SNP have made. So for all the First Minister's bluster today, he can't ignore the fact that there are people across our country who are being forced to remortgage their home to pay for hip replacements. There are mothers going without food in order to feed their children. There are families travelling south to get their child a private mental health diagnosis. And cash-strapped families are being made to pay more and get less from their public services. But what's the SNP focused on instead? Desperately trying to cling on to power. They are so divided, so chaotic, and so dysfunctional that they can't now provide the stable, competent government our country needs. That's why we need an election, but they don't want to call one. Why? Is it because they fear the judgment of the Scottish people.
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, can I remind Anna Sarwar, it was 24 hours ago, in fact less than 24 hours ago, this Parliament voted to give confidence the SNP-led Scottish government. And let me also say to him, let me also say to Anna Sarwar, that whoever succeeds me, what they can say unequivocally is that we stand proud of not just our record, but the policies, of course, that we have enacted over 17 years. And the thing with the difference between myself, my colleagues in the front benches here, colleagues such as John Swinney and Kate Forbes, is that we are, of course, consistent in our principles. The only consistency in Anna Sarwar is his complete and utter inconsistency. Yeah. And I'm surprised that he is not more embarrassed by that inconsistency. He's U-turned, of course, on the two-child limit and rape clause. Anna Sarwar has U-turned on bankers' bonuses. Anna Sarwar has U-turned on progressive taxation. He's U-turned on the £28 billion Green Prosperity Fund. He's U-turned on rejoining the European Union. He's U-turned on his support for compensation for the WASPI woman. Anna Sarwar says continuity won't cut it. It'd be nice if, for 5 minutes, Anna Sarwar could continue with one principle without dumping it, Presiding Officer.
Question number three, Lorna Slater.
The First Minister's government announced a new package of measures to ramp up action on climate change just a few weeks ago. Since then, though, he has needlessly ended the progressive, pro-independence government majority brought about by the Butte House Agreement. Responding to the climate emergency was at the core of that agreement, and I'm proud of what the Scottish Greens achieved during our time in government. Free bus travel for under-22s, banning new incinerators and ending fossil fuel heating in new build homes. These actions are already driving down our climate emissions. But climate action
Let's
is now
hear Ms.
under
Slater.
Threat. Climate action is now under threat. So can he confirm to me today if the Scottish Government will recommit to the package of climate action announced, or will his last act as First Minister be watering down climate action and betraying future generations?
First Minister.
Officer, can I say that this government for 17 years, whether that was before the Butte House Agreement or as part of the Butte House Agreement, has a very proud track record of standing up to tackle the climate crisis. And of course, we are proud of the achievements that were made with the cooperation with the Greens. But we had a long-standing record on tackling climate crisis before we were in a cooperation agreement with the Greens. And what I would also say on progressive values, which I've heard Lorna Slater talk about in recent days, once again, our manifesto, the manifesto that we stood on, the manifesto that ensured that the SNP was, by quite some considerable distance, the largest party in this parliament, was one that was rooted in progressive social values. So I would say to Lorna Slater, of course, it will be for my successor to come to this chamber and, of course, my successor's cabinet to make clear their priorities in tackling the climate crisis. That accelerated policy package is one that, of course, this government absolutely supports. But I would say to the Greens, it's now time for all of us, of course, on an issue-by-issue basis, to make sure that we continue to collaborate and work closely together. And I've got no doubt that the Greens will do that with whoever my successor is.
Lorna Slater.
One of the policies contained in the Butte House Agreement was to conduct a climate compatibility assessment of the proposed dualling of the A96. That assessment is now long overdue. Achieving our climate goals means drastically driving down car use. The Infrastructure Commission for Scotland, the Climate Change Committee, and Transform Scotland have all said new road building to increase capacity
Let's
is not compatible with the drive to net zero. So can I ask the First Minister, when will his government publish the climate compatibility assessment for the A96? And when it inevitably says we cannot afford, for the sake of future generations, to dual that road in full, will he commit to investing the money earmarked for this project into safety improvements and better public transport for communities who live along the route?
First Minister.
Later, we'll know, of course, that it's really important for these reviews to conclude, to complete, before, of course, we update Parliament. So, again, it will be for my successor, no doubt, to give an update to Parliament on that matter. But when it comes to transport, I think we can tell a good story in terms of the investment that we've made in electric vehicle charging points and infrastructure, for example, and again, which we look to accelerate. We can talk about the fact that since 2011, we provided over £200 million of interest-free loans through the Low Carbon Trust loan scheme for the purchase of zero emissions vehicles. We're committed to work with public bodies to decarbonise the public sector fleet, and we've provided £80 million to date to support the procurement of more than 4,000 zero and ultra-low emission vehicles, as well as charging and refuelling infrastructure. So there is, we have a proud record, of course, of building infrastructure, be that road infrastructure or indeed others, but we also have a very proud record of ensuring we continue to invest in low emission transport and affordable public transport, and we'll continue to do that again, I suspect, regardless of who my successor is.
Thank you. I'll just say at this point we have many questions still to be put, and more concise questions and responses will enable more members that opportunity. And at question number four, I call Karen Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the potential impact on Police Scotland and devolved agencies of reports that the Home Office has launched a major operation to detain asylum seekers across the UK following the passing of the UK Safety of Rwanda Asylum and Immigration Act 2024.
First Minister.
Well, let me be very clear. The dog whistle politics we have seen displayed this week through the disgusting Home Office footage and, frankly, the accompanying Westminster rhetoric has no place here in Scotland. This government has consistently opposed the Rwanda Act, while other members of this chamber have, in their capacity of, as MPs, voted for it. We have absolutely opposed the Rwanda Act and the Illegal Migration Act. The hostile environment rhetoric is a symptom of a broken Westminster system that's focused on constantly attacking the most vulnerable and is a complete abdication of the UK's not just moral responsibility, but its international obligations as well. Any unannounced Home Office immigration enforcement visits will raise concern and anxiety right across our communities. While Police Scotland, of course, have a role in maintaining public order and public safety, they will never assist in the removal of asylum seekers or other migrants. Ministers will continue to press our deep concerns on reserved asylum policy to the UK counterparts.
Karen Adam.
I thank the First Minister for that answer. With the news that the Home Office raids have begun, is the First Minister as sickened as I am and many of my constituents are the fact that this unworkable policy has been forced upon Scotland by a very fear-mongering and xenophobic UK government?
First Minister.
I agree entirely. I agree entirely with Karen Adam. And I do, though, have to say that I have great faith in the people of Scotland, who will ever forget the heroic actions of those in Kenmure Street, for example. But let me say, from a government perspective, we stand absolutely steadfast in our opposition to the Rwanda Act and Illegal Migration Act. I deplore the inhumane Home Office enforcement action that we've seen. Detaining people to forcibly remove them to Rwanda is cruel and punishes some of the most vulnerable in our society. And really, it is at times like this that we all have an obligation to just step back, actually think about what's going on here. That in a country, in the UK, where those who flee often persecution, war, or extreme poverty come to our shores, what has happened to the UK that has often opened its homes, its hearts, its arms to people who are seeking sanctuary? Instead, we have a UK government that wants to pit community against community, person against person, race against race. And I'm afraid that inflammatory rhetoric, that stoking the flames of division, is only detrimental for each and every single one of us. So my plea to end this question, Presiding Officer, is to every single political party, particularly in a general election year, it's so important that we show some moral leadership in relation to some of the most divisive issues. And I hope every single member of this chamber will play their part in ensuring that we put out the flames as opposed to stoke the flames of racial, religious tension that I'm afraid this Rwanda Act undoubtedly inflames.
Question number five, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister, in light of new reported data that nearly one in five shop premises in Scottish cities lie empty, what action the Scottish Government is taking to support the retail sector?
First Minister.
For an important question, raising an important issue indeed. Retail is an essential component of a vibrant city centre economy and indeed town centre economy too. A retail strategy sets out how we will work with businesses and trade unions to deliver strong and prosperous retail sector. It contains very specific actions, such as supporting businesses where possible to utilise existing vacant space to strengthen retail's contribution to the economic and social success of communities, and encourages our retailers to promote city centres as retail and cultural destinations. Many retailers in Scotland also benefit, of course, from the Small Business Bonus Scheme, the most generous of its kind in the UK, which offers up to 100% relief from non-domestic rates.
Joe Fraser.
Can I thank the First Minister for his response? Research from the Sunday Post newspaper shows an alarming shop vacancy rate in Scottish cities, 19.5% in Aberdeen, 18% in Dundee, 18.5% in Perth. Now, the decline of our traditional retail centres is well documented. A Conservative government down south has given retail, hospitality and leisure premises 75% rate relief for 2 years, but this has not been passed on by the Scottish government, despite having the Barnett consequentials to do so. So if the Scottish government isn't going to do that, what is the other intervention that's going to make a real difference before we see many more closures in our high streets?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, first let me say, of course, that if we had followed the logic of what Murdo Fraser was asking us to have done, that would have meant, of course, passing on every single penny of consequentials to
and
businesses
more.
But, of course, that would have been at the expense of the investment that we've made in the National Health Service. That would have been at the expense of the investment, real terms increase, that we've made to education, to our justice services. And his party, the Conservative Party in the UK government, of course, chose to give tax cuts that will put money in the pockets of the wealthy at the expense of the NHS, presiding officer. So when it comes to the pressures that businesses are facing, small or large, let me remind Murdo Fraser of the unmitigated disaster that Brexit has been, presiding officer. The number one issue that businesses raise with me is the high energy costs related, of course, to that disastrous mini budget, high inflation costs, high food prices, all because of Murdo Fraser's party mishandling of the economy.
Absolutely.
So we'll continue to invest both in public services and supporting businesses, and that's why they benefit from the most generous rates relief, small business rates relief, anywhere in the UK.
Question number six, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what recent discussion the Scottish Government has had with environmental groups and communities regarding how it plans to deliver strong action on climate change following the removal of the 2030 climate target.
First Minister.
The Government regularly engages with environmental groups and communities on tackling climate change. For example, the Cabinet Secretary for Wellbeing Economy, Net Zero and Energy held a roundtable with ENGOs late March, to discuss our climate targets. I've also regularly met with a number of organisations on an individual basis. Of course, these discussions will continue as we consider further action on climate change based on the Climate Change Committee's advice. More generally, it is vital that everyone understands the scale of the climate emergency. Our public engagement strategy sets out our vision for everyone to embrace their role in our transition to Net Zero Scotland. That's why we're providing a vehicle for communities to engage in collective climate action through our network of climate action hubs, something I know the member is aware of. We provided around £4 million in 23-24 to expand the network of hubs right across the country.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the First Minister for the answer. Will the Scottish Government support my colleague Sarah Boyack's amendments to place a purpose of a circular economy in Scotland on the face of the bill, and my colleague Monica Lennon's amendment to put in place a reusable nappy scheme which would take concrete action to reduce consumption-based carbon emission here in Scotland and properly fund local authorities so they can deliver the transformation we need in our local communities?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, of course, any amendments to any legislation will be looked at on their own merits. And what I would say to Faisal Chowdhury, and I know he will absolutely understand this, is that it's important, particularly given we are operating as a minority government, that we continue to hear good ideas and cooperate right across parties where we can. But I would also equally say to Faisal Chowdhury that when it comes to tackling the climate crisis, it makes that imperative, that obligation, far more difficult Whenever we bring even the mildest of action to this chamber, it's opposed by, for example, the UK Labour Party, Scottish Labour Party, forgive me, that was a Freudian slip, the Scottish Labour Party, and indeed the opposition. They opposed, of course, in Glasgow, our introduction of low emission zones. They opposed in this Parliament a workplace parking levy. They are trying to water down new heating standards. They've also, of course, time and time again, refused to back any measure that we bring. So for Faisal Chowdhury, of course, we will look at the amendments that he has suggested, or the ideas that he suggested. I would hope his party will do the same so we can work together to tackle the biggest challenge, the existential challenge, our planet faces.
I call John Mason.
Thank you. Can the First Minister confirm that Scotland's climate ambitions are very dependent on Westminster funding? And if a future Labour government are just to carry on copying the Tory policies as they seem to be doing, Scotland will continue to struggle to make climate progress.
First Minister.
That's absolutely right. And I've asked Anna Sawar and the Labour Party on a number of occasions, very gently, just to confirm whether or not they would reverse the £1.3 billion capital cut to our budget that the Tories have imposed on us for the next few years. And every time I ask that question, I get a lot of waffle, but I don't get an answer back. And that is the challenge here, because when it comes to investing in tackling the climate crisis, capital infrastructure, capital infrastructure is going to be absolutely key, absolutely vital to tackling the climate crisis. We expect the Conservatives to cut our capital budget to the bone. What we need Labour to do is move away from Tory tax and spending plans so we have a chance to tackle, as I say, what is the biggest challenge our planet faces.
Tess White.
Presiding Officer. First Minister, a protest is underway outside the Scottish Parliament against the monster pylon pathway proposed by transmission operator SSEN for the north of Scotland. Communities are alarmed and anxious. The First Minister says he doesn't want waffle, so will the First Minister commit to sit down with campaigners and explain how his government will use its devolved powers to respond to their concerns?
First Minister.
Well aware, of course, in relation to the protest that's taking place, I should say that we do strongly support action to reform the connection process so that Scottish projects can connect to the grid when they are ready to do so. The powers to reform the grid connection process are, of course, reserved to the UK government and require action at a UK level. When it comes to Scotland's, we do have, of course, the most stringent environmental impact regulations in the world, and our planning and consenting system ensures that local communities can have their say, and all applications must be subject to site-specific assessments. It's not appropriate for ministers to comment on potential projects that may come forward for determinations. And as our NPF4 makes abundantly clear, potential impacts on communities, nature, and others are important considerations in the decision-making process. And I would say to Tess White, it's important, of course, to listen to our communities. It's important to hear from our communities, consult and engage with our communities. Let's also remind ourselves it is equally important that when it comes to powering Scotland's renewable potential in particular for the future, it's going to be vital, in fact, that whoever is in the UK government puts their hand in their pocket and invests in our grid infrastructure. Yeah. And all of us have a responsibility to talk up the importance, I think, of grid infrastructure. If we don't do that, then we're simply not going to have the renewables boom that we are very much on the precipice and on the cusp of. So let's, of course, engage with our communities. Let's also make it abundantly clear that investment in the grid is absolutely required.
Absolutely. Question number 7, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the First Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has made of the potential impact on devolved social security benefits of the UK Government's proposed reforms to disability benefits.
First Minister.
I can give a categoric assurance that the SNP Government, and I can say this even on behalf of my potential successor, that whoever's in this office will make it clear that the SNP-led Scottish Government will never accept the cruel welfare reforms being pursued by the UK Government. These punitive proposals only further stigmatise and impoverish disabled people and have rightly been called out by stakeholders as, and I quote, a reckless assault on disabled people. In contrast, Scotland's social security system was designed, its foundation blocks, with the principles of dignity, fairness and respect. Those are the values of this government, that the values of the people of Scotland, because disability payments are there for all of us whenever we should need them, should they be required. The Scottish Government is committed to continuing to deliver adult disability payments in a compassionate and caring way. I know the Cabinet Secretary has sought urgent clarification from the DWP earlier this week that people receiving our adult disability payment will not be penalised and will continue to automatically receive the reserve benefits that they rely on. And I call on the UK Government to also provide assurance that it will not seek to impose any resultant cuts to expenditure on the Scottish Government. Yeah.
Colette Stevenson.
I thank the First Minister for that response. Social Security Scotland is built on the principles of dignity, fairness and respect. In contrast, the UK Government continue to favour an outdated blame and shame approach. Does the First Minister share my concerns that these narratives could have a detrimental impact on disabled people in Scotland applying for the support that they are entitled to, and can he outline measures that can be taken to minimise the impact?
First Minister.
I absolutely agree with that, and I'm clear that Social Security is a human right. It's an investment in our society, it's an investment in the people. That's why we have transformed financial support for disabled people in Scotland, establishing a very radically different system, as I've already said, based on the foundation blocks of fairness, dignity and respect. And these proposals, these changes, much like the Rwanda bill we spoke about earlier on, they're just the latest example of the Conservatives punching down, yeah, of punishing marginalised communities to make up for their own failings. It's transparent for everyone to see. Yeah. So while the Department for Work and Pensions continue to pursue punitive measures, which will only serve to stigmatise and dehumanise disabled people, we will proactively ensure that people are aware of and encouraged to access the financial support that they are entitled to, and will continue to work in partnership with disabled people, both through our ongoing review of adult disability payment and in our continued commitment to supporting people to access all of their social security entitlements.
Thank you. We move to constituency and general supplementaries. I call Michael Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hundreds of women in the Grampian region are travelling hundreds of miles to the Central Belt for vital breast cancer treatment. I was alerted to this issue this week by a clinician who has told me there are great concerns as to the impact of these treatment delays on patients' chances of recovery. The First Minister knows that this situation is intolerable. Coupled with issues in the NHS Tayside, which I've raised here many times, there is a significant issue regarding breast cancer care in the northeast of Scotland. Why has this happened, and what can the First Minister do to fix the situation? What guarantees can he offer today that NHS Grampian is working urgently to restore a full service? Delays to cancer treatment cost lives, First Minister. Will you commit to a full assessment of the devastating impact of treatment delays for these women?
First Minister.
You say that Michael Mara raises this important issue. He's obviously raised this issue before in relation to Tayside as well, and he's right, of course, to do so, because we don't want any delay in treatment. I should say, of course, those who are asked to travel for treatment, wherever they're asked to travel, will get the best care possible. But of course, we want them to be treated as close to home as they possibly can be. And that's why we've increased our funding and indeed headcount in relation to oncologists and consultants over the years. But there continues to be, in some health boards, including Grampian, a continued shortage. And therefore, I'll ask the Health Secretary to write to Michael Mara with the details of the conversations he has had with Grampian, but also with other health boards where there is a shortage, so that we can get to a position where the best treatment for breast cancer and indeed for any other condition is as close to home as possible.
Bob Doris.
Thank you, President Officer. Summer approaches, my constituents in Maryhill and Springburn will increasingly be subjected to the dangers of the irresponsible use of off-road vehicles such as quad bikes. People have been injured and lives have been lost, both riders and the wider public. At Westminster, Glasgow North East MP Anne McLaughlin is seeking a legislative change to require off-road vehicle registration, and the Home Office have promised to establish a task force, but we must do stuff here in Scotland also. Can I ask the First Minister what we can do here in Scotland, such as supporting Police Scotland in their inevitable and the often hazardous task of clamping down on irresponsible off-road vehicle use, including enforcement, but also importantly promoting responsible usage? And will the Scottish Government meet with me to see what work can be done here in Scotland?
First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I do share the concerns of the member regarding the antisocial behaviour that can be associated with these vehicles and the risk to the safety of both the public and the riders. The legislation governing the registration of off-road vehicles, including quad bikes, is reserved to the UK government. So it's there that we need action. And of course, Bob Doris is right to mention the legislative change that Anne McLaughlin MP is pushing for. It's a very sensible legislative change that I hope MPs can back. And I fully support Police Scotland, its partners in dealing with and handling their misuse. Local policing teams are ideally placed to engage with members of the local community to identify where the misuse of such vehicles is causing problems in our neighbourhoods.
And Ross McCall.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recorded sexual crimes in Dunfermline are now higher than they were before the pandemic, with 1,000 sexual crimes reported in the city since 2017. 223 of these crimes were reported in 2022-23, significantly higher than 163 reported in 2019-20, before the pandemic. Local charities such as Safe Space, an organisation who supports survivors of child sex abuse in Dunfermline, work tirelessly to support victims of these horrendous crimes, but the numbers coming forward to use the services such as these are simply overwhelming. First Minister, it's obvious that current policy is not working. So what will the Scottish Government do to halt this alarming increase in sexual crime?
First Minister.
Well, can I thank Ross McCall for raising what is an exceptionally important issue indeed. And of course, what we have always said in this Government is that we must improve the criminal justice system for those who unfortunately end up as victims and survivors of sexual offences, and I hope that we can get the support of the Conservatives in that. In terms of the prevention element, I know that Police Scotland are working extensively, tirelessly, in order to try to work with communities in relation to prevent sexual crimes from taking place in the first place. And organisations like Safe Space, many other third sector organisations, we will seek to do what we can to support them. I will ensure that the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Home Affairs does write to Ros McCall with some of the detail in terms of what we can do, both working in collaboration with Police Scotland, but also crucially in collaboration with third sector organisations, excellent third sector organisations like Safe Space.
Thank you. That concludes First Minister's questions. The next item of business, point of order, Jamie Green.
Forgive me, Presiding Officer, for not giving advance notice, but I noticed that only three members today from the back benches were able to submit constituency or supplementary questions. Unfortunately, this has become a bit of a pattern at First Minister's questions, and I know a number of us from right across the benches will have very pertinent issues to raise. I did wonder, Presiding Officer, if you were reviewing any potential changes to the format of FMQs that would allow for a far wider range and volume of backbench questions to be asked and for the First Minister to answer them. Yeah.
I thank Mr Green for his point of order. I think it's fair to say that I have shared my expectations with members on this issue on many occasions. I have put forward my recommendation for timings of questions and responses. It's fair to say there's still significant work to be done in this area. I should also note at this point that at the beginning of Session 5, the Parliament extended this session for the very purpose Mr Green outlines, and it's certainly my hope that we see a real move towards that, because it's really important that as many members as possible have those opportunities. Thank you. There will now be a short suspension to allow those leaving the chamber and public gallery to do so before the next item begins.